Okay, so this is Neal Morse, and this is musicians having coffee and talking about stuff.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
And so we can talk about anything, you know, anything you want. You can talk absolutely. About Siberia, you can talk about boils, you can talk about...
Indeed.
Anything that you'd like to talk about.
They're both fascinating subjects about which I know very little.
Yes.
Fortunately, with the... With the latter, Siberia. At least I've been to Russia, not Siberia, but I have. And I guess you've played in Russia yourself, have you?
I've only sang in a choir there. Right after the wall came down, my dad was a choir director, and he there was an all Unitarian group of mostly choir directors from all over America. And they put together this choir, and they needed another tenor, and my dad said he would pay for me to go. And so we toured Russia, and it was great because we only sang a concert like every 3 days, and the rest of the time we were just touring around, and it was amazing. It was right after the wall came down, and it was incredible.
Yes. There used to be a restaurant in King's Road, London, the heart of the swinging 60s, which was called Borscht and Tears. Borscht being, I guess, some Russian delicacy, one assumes.
Yeah, it was beet soup with sour cream in it.
Yeah, that's it. So there would, you know, there was that. And I just remember it was in the days before I'd really grown up, you know, in the 60s, I was still in my teens, you know. And and in the early days, I used to see these fascinating places, and I had no money to go inside them, and I was far too young and all of that. But my school was situated very near Chelsea football ground, the soccer team, Chelsea.
Really?
It was situated there. And we lived in Pimlico, and it was about a mile or a mile and a half along King's Road. And you could see the whole of the 1960s developing in front of your eyes. The fashions, Rolling Stones, when they were very young, were marching up and down the street very, very often.
Right.
The Beatles were literally going to a restaurant just around the corner, which I was always fascinated. Oh, seem to have lost you again. Oh, my God.
Yeah, somebody called me.
Okay. Anyway, it always seemed like... It always seemed like with the 1960s that the party was going on somewhere else, usually with your older brothers in song, you know, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles. The Stones were 5 years older or so, it seemed. The Beatles, in some cases, were 10 years older. Lennon was born in 1940. I was born in 1950.
And I was born in 1960. I was born in 1960.
Wow, this is it. You know, so I turned 71 this year.
Oh, wow.
Which I'm not, but there we go. No. I'm merely 17, dear boy, you know. The only time I ever had any contact with John Lennon, and this you might find this very strange, I went to see a woman who was a medium in London at the Spiritualist Association of Great Britain.
No kidding.
Call them devil worshippers, whatever you like. And this woman said, have you got any anything with John Lennon? And I said, well, funnily enough, I've just recorded a song that John Lennon only recorded in demo form, which was called Grow Old Along With Me, World Without End, brackets, World Without End. And at that time, I had some pals in Bermuda who were trying to get a film made of Lennon's life, a kind of biopic in a way. And they found a guy called Gary Gibson who looked the spitting image of John Lennon and sounded exactly like him as well.
Oh, wow.
And he was doing a performance of Twist and Shout, and I thought it was Lennon, but it was this guy. So he was absolutely made for the film. And I recorded a version of this song and kind of updated it and really went to town over it. And it was this medium woman said, have you got any, you know, connection with John Lennon? And I said, well, I just recorded this song. And he said, and you were thinking this woman said to me, and you were thinking of sending it to Yoko, weren't you, with a bunch of red roses? And I said, well, yes, funny enough, I was. And Yoko Ono was going to perform in London at that time.
Oh, wow.
And I did get this song to her, and I did send her some roses, and I did meet her.
Ah.
And so, how strange. No, never met. The only Beatle I met in reality was Paul McCartney at one point, and I had a conversation with him, which was very sweet and very brief.
Mm-hmm.
The Stones, I'd met Mick Jagger. I didn't mean to be bragging about all of this sort of stuff, but you know, it's very, very odd. Yeah, two Stones I met, and it was a conversation with Jagger when he was in Brazil, and it was a conversation with Bill Wyman, obviously when he was still a Stone, at the Led Zeppelin reunion. They only had one, which was for Ahmet Ertegun of Atlantic Records when he passed.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But everybody saw it as the Led Zeppelin reunion. But as far as Zepp themselves were concerned, and particularly Robert Plant, he saw it as, you know, a tribute to Ahmet Ertegun. And I happened to be there. I didn't have a ticket, but I was working. It sounds like name drop, and I do apologize for this.
No, it's
fine.
But
I was working with Chris Squire at the time. We were doing a number of things, projects together.
Oh, were you doing the Squacket thing?
Squacket thing, that's right.
Yeah.
And he said to me, well, if you want to go to the gig, why don't you just carry my guitar in? So I used to, you know, so I drove him to the gig with my wife and his wife, Scotty, and my wife, Jo. And I carried his guitar in, so I was his roadie for the night. You know what I mean? He said, get me through the door. And fine. And, you know, it was actually, you know, an extraordinary gig. You know, we were standing right at the back in a box, and it was still deafeningly loud. I think it was the loudest gig I'd ever been at. And I know that John Paul Jones, who I'd done something with in Japan, and again, I do apologize for name dropping. We did a thing called Guitar Wars with Nuno Bettencourt and Paul Gilbert.
Oh, wow, great.
And Mike Luter, and all very lovely, totally under-rehearsed, but everyone blistering away as fast as they could.
Right.
Trying to knock each other off the perch, as guitarists do when they get together.
Yes, yes, of course.
And, at that time, now, John Paul Jones had just done the thing with, the guys from, I'm not going to get the names right, the thing that he did, was it Them Crooked Buzzards or a name like that, the name of the band that he'd had with, you know, the guys that were the spin-off from, I'm losing it, Mr. Amnesia here. But anyway.
Yeah, you know, I'd love to help you out, but I'm not sure.
And he said, if you thought that was loud, you know, this thing that he'd done with Dave Grohl was just hugely loud.
Uh-huh. You know? Yeah.
So
it's the.
There we are.
I wish concerts wouldn't have to be so loud. In fact, I really appreciated it, Steve, when I saw you on the cruise to the edge.
Yeah.
The mix was lovely and not too loud at all. It was very nice.
Oh, good.
Very, very comfortable in the ears. I appreciate that.
I've always loved it. I've always loved doing those cruises, and I don't know about you, but you know, some of my friends in our musical fraternity feel uncomfortable about, you know, mixing with fans. But you know what? I don't mind it at all, unless I'm trying to get to the stage and I have to say something in this elevator full of people.
Right.
Because I've got to be on stage in 5 minutes, you know. I'll talk to anyone. I shouldn't be advertising this. I didn't say this. But, you know, provided you're not trying to sort of eat breakfast in seconds flat, or, you know, you've got to be somewhere to do a photo signing or something like that, you know yourself.
Yeah, there was a funny...
How did you find it? Did you love it?
Yeah, no, I enjoy it. Oh, yeah, we love it. There's a lot of funny things that happen. I remember there was this big to-do on one of them because I was to guest with my old band Spock's Beard in the theater like at 10 o'clock. And then Transatlantic and John Anderson were going on to close the cruise at the pool stage, I think at 11. Wow. And so I wasn't doing my thing with Spock's till about 10 minutes till 11. And the, you know, the idea was, how are we going to escort? Well, you know, they got this escort for me, and they took me down to the catacombs and walked.
Yeah.
Well, after we walked the length of the ship, you know, way down where all the crew is, and there's, because there's no borders or anything, then we go upstairs, and they put me in the elevator with all the fans that had just been at the show. So I'm like, hi. It's just
can't stop now, but on my way to
see you guys at the, and this is, you know, elevators are a little awkward anyway, right?
So I know he was too big time to sign my to sign my butt, because he said he had to be on stage. I never believed that.
Oh yeah, but most of the people are really great and really really nice. There was a funny moment one time. I was feeling emotional. I haven't told anybody about this. I was on the Spock's Beard was playing. My old band was playing on the pool stage.
Yeah.
And sometimes you just want to sit there and take it in and enjoy it.
Yeah.
You know?
Sure.
And so I'm on the stairs watching them. And frankly, I was kind of missing them. I was like, wow, there's my brother's in the band. There's my brother. And I was having a bit of an emotional moment. And this guy comes up, like, gets, like, way close talking, you know, like, total space invasion. And he's like, wow, I can't believe
what you're saying.
I can't believe I'm standing here with Neal Morse. I'm like, oh, not now, please. You know?
Right.
Mostly it's okay. You know?
Yeah. There's a time and a place, you know, I mean, and, what happens is that everyone is literally in the same boat, of course, you know, the cliche.
Yeah.
But there'll be moments when you'll see the mighty having, you know, somebody will have had a little bit too much to drink, or somebody's wife would, you know, be being carried. And, it's like, you know, it's kind of, you know, it's so natural in a way, you know, because you're all, you're all part of the crew at that point, you know. There is no separation unless you want to be very precious about it and remain in your cabin, only appear for your show, disappear off to be wafted into a private paradise somewhere.
Right.
That's not my style at all, and I suspect it's not yours. You know, I like to mix. I like to know what people like. I like to be at one with people, unless it gets too much. But usually people are respectful enough, you know, that it was okay. I used to love doing it when John Wetton was there. I loved doing it when Chris Squire was there. We only ever all performed on stage together one time, and it was Cruise to the Edge, and we all did a version of All Along the Watchtower.
Really?
It's there on YouTube. Yeah. And what you see is not a perfect performance. It's the gesture. It's that you see that camaraderie, you know, where everybody's kind of got their arms around each other and there's, you know, shoulder to shoulder. And it's a very lovely thing. So I always prize it. And, you know, it's such a shame that it doesn't look like, It didn't happen. We have to defer it, and it looks like it probably won't happen next year. Maybe it'll happen the year after. I'm always up for it whenever it's happening. Maybe it'll happen.
I hope maybe so. Maybe it'll
happen. Yeah, maybe it's 2023. No one has a crystal ball here. All I can say is, because, of course, we're on record saying this, is that I'm open for business when everyone else is open for business. And
yeah, me too.
Other than that, clairvoyance have I none.
Right. Yeah, who knows? Yeah, I've had a lot of people ask me what some of my favorite gigs are, and some of my favorite moments have been on the ship, but some really funny moments. I came out the last time we were there to do the Flying Colors set on the pool stage, and it was so windy. And they'd taken it, we were overtime an hour. They took so long to get us set. You know, you're waiting for your crew to say, okay, everything's set, you're ready to go on, you know. And so they finally say that, and we go on stage, intro tape, you know. And my computer has blown shut.
Hey.
With all the keyboard sounds in it, right? So
yes.
And it's not like you can just open it up and everything's there. You have to reboot and,
you know,
the show is going. And then for some reason, I left my lanyard on with my badge and the wind. Mm. So then they had another keyboard there. They had an organ that I could play. So I'm playing the organ and I'm trying to remember the words to the song while all this stuff is going on, you know?
Yeah.
And then the lanyard starts whipping me in the eye. It starts going,
oh my God. Oh.
And I'm singing, like a wheel of emotion. You know, I'm trying to be with the audience and sing this song while this thing's like whipping me in the eye. So then I try to take it off and it gets tangled in my headset. So now it's hanging halfway up my back. They finally had to come cut my lanyard off of me. It was so funny.
Yeah. You see, you're allowing people backstage into the reality saying all of that. You know, those who worship you as a god will be, you know, enlightened and appalled in equal measure, because there we are. You see, it's like, oh, you mean he has those problems too? You know, but surely not. And we're all like that. You know, we all have those moments where, I remember being on stage and falling over the monitors because I hadn't had a chance to do a sound check and pinned down by the weight of a Les Paul at the time in Italy years ago, cold sober. But, you know, when you're a dead fly on a stage with not being able to move with your feet up in the air, you know, you can't, you know, that's all pretense is over. You know, it's the same as Laurence Olivier talking about this sort of stuff, you know.
Right.
When some guy's trousers have fallen down or whatever, you know, that's it.
We wouldn't know things like that would ever happen to you, Steve. That would never happen to you.
No, that would never happen to you. But, you know, it always seems at the beginning when you start out as a professional that mistakes like the sort of stuff you're talking about only happen to your band, to you. And you don't know until you start sharing old war stories like this, you know, with everyone, that you think that's bad. Well, I remember the time that blah, 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 you know,
right.
And the time when...
Spinal Tap moments.
The Spinal Tap moments where everything had died a death and the guitarist is hitting the stage with a shoe because everything else has died. You know?
Right.
And I remember doing push-ups on a gig when all else had failed, and I happened to be going through a particularly fit phase at the time where I could, you know. And but you know, these are not the things for which we will be remembered. But it's how do you get through? You're as human as anyone else, and I wouldn't change it. Would you? You know, for all those things, you know, the very first gig I ever did with Genesis, where I played so many bum notes that I'm surprised that I didn't get sacked immediately, you know, fired immediately.
Really? Where was the first gig?
That was University College in London, and I just was using a new fuzz box, and it was fine for sound check, and yet, of course, everyone turned up. The guitar box was feeding back like crazy, you know. I'd never used a stack live professionally. So because of this feedback, I forgot every single down note I was supposed to be playing.
Right.
So it was a bit like the atonal Genesis set, you know. You survive these things. Death of a thousand cuts, I felt, might be easier. but just totally... But do you get up on the horse when you are unseated thusly? Answer, yes, or else you wouldn't still be doing it. Have you?
Yeah.
You must have had lots of moments like this as well. We're talking about embarrassing moments, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes. Oh, yeah. In fact, wound up talking about a lot of them on this podcast. Because, I did one with my brother, and we, you know, grew up doing crazy, just crazy gigs together, circus gigs, you know, just insane things with, you know, all kind. I think in its own way, all my years of playing what I would call death gigs prepared me. I remember right in the middle of a festival, not a big festival, it was a Prog festival, so a smaller one.
Yeah.
But like my rig went down right at a pivotal moment in the music, mm-hmm. you know, right before the big climax. And and I, you know, so we kind of stood there, my tech came out, we had to restart the thing and, you know, do all that. But it struck me what some of the people backstage said. They said they'd never seen anybody handle something like that with such, you know, calm. And I'm like, well, I've just I've been through it so many times.
I think this is the thing about, you know, when suddenly the script has all been torn up, the amp has died, the drummer has had a heart attack, whatever it is, and the act keeps going. I mean, God, we had this so many times back in the day in Italy, where in the 1970s when we used to tour back then with the old band, every gig the power would always go. It'd be some generator that gave up the ghost. The lights would go out, power would go. There might be one mic working, and Peter Gabriel would be going, you know, Phil, can we do our, you know, whistling along with some Colonel Bogey moment, you know, and just doing something British that until the power comes back on. And I guess it's how you handle that. For guitarists, it has to be, everything's blown up. Keyboard player's looking at me saying, his computer's gone, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm looking at Jonas Reingold and Craig Blundell and go, well, keyboards have died a death, but perhaps, you know, the three of us or four of us can, with Rob Townsend, we can suddenly do a blues.
Right, or sing something, or, you know, try to
just
sing.
You know, the last thing on your mind. But
yeah.
But, and then afterwards, you get the occasional person who would say, well, actually, I really enjoyed that. You know, the fact that it wasn't difficult music.
Yeah.
It was merely honest music. It was played for fun. It was played for laughs. And,
yeah. I've heard that many times. Actually, people have been to the gigs where everything broke, and people have been to the gigs where everything went smoothly. And many times they'll say, you know, I really enjoyed the one where everything broke because it was so unique.
That's right.
Yeah, because people want to connect, you know.
How do you handle that? You know, it's a bit like, what do you remember? Things that went wonderfully well, or do you remember lost loves? For all their...
Yeah.
Shouldn't say warts and all. That would sound...
a bit derogatory.
derogatory, exactly. But... you know, it's like, what do you remember, you know? And I suppose, you know, you train and you train and professionals, and, you know, the sound gets smoother and smoother, you know, the band is right on the money, and suddenly there's a cloud burst on a sunny day.
You must have a lot of that. Yeah, I would think you guys would have had a lot of that, like during the Lamb tour, with all the technology you were trying to use and whatnot.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we had stuff where Monsieur Gabriel used to throw something at some rocks, and there would be an explosion. And one night, I think it was in Oslo in Norway, when someone put too much flash powder in the bit by the rock that would go off, that was coordinated, and it just blew out all of the all of the PA bins, and so the gig just finished. At that moment, that was it. actually, went up. I remember seeing Floyd with a similar moment where they used to fly the plane into the stage, and this was when we're doing Dark Side at a theatre called the Rainbow in London, which the theatre no longer it exists, but it is no longer a rock and roll venue.
Mm.
And the sound when the plane crashes into the stage and the explosion was so loud, my ears were just, you know, they were just killing me afterwards.
Wow.
It's a wonder that any of us have got any hearing left at all.
Right.
How's yours these days? Shouldn't I?
It's okay. Last time I had it checked, but there is quite a bit of ringing. That's for sure. You know, I wanted to talk to you. I know that you have a lot of experience with collaborating and then with not collaborating, which I do as well. And I heard it mentioned that in one of your interviews, you talked about, you know, the reason why you wanted to, you know, start your solo career and not be in Genesis anymore was, you said one word, autonomy. Yeah.
Yes.
And I thought that was really interesting. How shall I say it? I grapple or I deal with the same sort of issues. I really like working and writing on my own and calling all the shots. But I also do. I really love collaborating. I really love getting with other people. But what a challenge it is.
Well, it is, and I think songwriting partnerships. I mean, I have this thing. I'm working on an album at the moment because I guess we are always working on something. That's the nature of the perennial musician, singer, songwriter, guitarist, whatever we are, all of those things. And I actually enjoy the process of saying, I don't know what should happen next. Over to you, my partner, whoever that might be, whether that's my wife, Jo, who when we met, she was a filmmaker and she was after me doing films that she was making, and she'd been trained as a violinist as a kid. Now, and Roger King, who engineers my albums and plays keyboards in the band that we go out with, and I seem to naturally orientate towards these two collaborators, where, like you, I'm working at home, and it's very. It's very easy. It's a very natural process. It's not like being in a band where people are vying for supremacy. God knows why, because I always think what serves the music ought to be everyone's God.
Yeah.
What serves the music is the priority is as far as I'm concerned. But not everybody is the same. I think, you know, that not everybody wants to share. Some people want to dominate, etc. And I always think, you know, there's this thing about the beauty of solo careers as such. You've been in a band, I've been in a band, you know, and you several experiences of this sort of thing. But the beauty of the solo experience is that you are potentially the Führer, the dictator. You can write everything you like, but at the same time, you can allow others in to any degree that you want. And that's a very natural process. Whereas I think bands, you know, tend to have one dominant character or a clique. And I'm not going to mention any names here, but you know, you get factions and all of that. But
yeah, isn't that a drag? I wish it wasn't that way.
Well, that's, you know, band politics are something that, you know, you can produce great work, you know, amongst, you know, people in bands that you know. And they will travel in separate vehicles to the gig and never talk to each other, and they merely have a professional rather than a personal relationship. It's never been that bad with me because, you know, I've always tried to sort of understand the people that I work with. But competitiveness versus cooperation, and unless you've been there, you know, I don't expect that a listener or someone in the audience to understand what I'm talking about. But, you know, competitiveness gets in the way so much, you know, of of beautiful songs. I remember this with Genesis with Peter Gabriel, where he would sometimes bring in a really beautiful idea, and then, you know, that would end up being a stillborn child, and it would be a shock to me that you know, something so lovely, it might take decades for that same idea to come to fruition. I would try and redress the balance over time as I realized, you know, here was something worth preserving. There's got to be a way of making that happen. So, you know,
yeah,
a stillborn idea can really fester, or you go, well, honor needs to be satisfied, and that song that you tried to introduce when nobody was interested or one person stood in the way had the power of veto. I talk about, you know, band politics, and I've seen it time and time again. An idea that's great that everyone else agrees with, and one guy has got the power of veto. Boom, 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 you know.
Right, yeah.
I mean, please.
It's interesting how that happens, isn't it? How does that happen?
Yeah, well, I don't know how it happens, but I guess eventually the music can be served. But I, you know,
right.
I think it can take a long time to be in a position of sufficient power where you can set aside those politics and say, well, you know, here's an idea that was presented this way. I can do it this way because I'm not subscribing to the limitations of what a band comes up with. I mean, you think of someone like George Harrison, you know, coming up with his debut, his three albums, not just one. I mean, my God, All Things Must Pass, you know.
Right, Yeah, the challenge for me with all that is, you know, if you have a beautiful idea, you feel like, you know, you've been given, it's like a gift, you
it's
know,
a gift.
Yeah,
yes,
you know, no matter how you look at that, you know, I look at it like a gift from God, you know, you've been given this thing, and then you feel like, I don't know if I should bring it to the team because they're going to want to change it. You know, most teams, they're there to create. I understand that. They want to create together.
Yeah.
But sometimes some of my most precious little themes or whatever, I'll hold them back sometimes. And then I feel funny about that. But sometimes if you feel like you've been given something and it's perfect just the way that it is.
Yeah.
Then it's a challenge of whether to share or not, and you know,
it's
of course,
difficult.
Yeah, of course, the challenge then, if it's all on you, if you know, like I made a album all completely on my own, pretty much last year during COVID because we couldn't really get together and collaborate. So, and collaborating, well, you know, you really need to be in the room together, I think, and or it's best that way. So I made an album called Solo Gratia, which was all, you know. I got to have my way, but then, you know, I've gotten also quite used to the, what you were saying about, like, you know, what, do you have any ideas here? You kind of come up to a precipice in a piece sometimes, and you're not sure which direction
Absolutely.
To go. And so the other side of the coin is like, oh man, when I have to make all the decisions myself, it's like, is this good? Are you sure? Boy, you know, so that's, I guess the answer is it's challenging all the way around. I just think it's interesting. There's something about the tension of the bands.
Yes.
I think that's part of the, somehow it's part of the creative force that people love so much.
Yes. Well, art functions outside of those tensions and the personality that is born from all the individuals is not dependent on you know, the good graces and enjoyment of all the individuals. You know, the politics are going on the whole down time, but you know, I mean, when Genesis was doing Land Lies Down on Broadway, you had a band that was in a state of disarray and decay, and
right,
Peter was going one way, the band were going the other. You know, it's as if everyone's locking horns and
right. But aren't many of your favorite albums? I mean, let's take the Beatles' White Album, for example.
Yes.
Sorry, somebody else called me.
That's okay.
I'm not used to doing this on my phone.
sure.
And I don't even know how to shut all that stuff off. But the Beatles' White Album was like that. What, you know, I mean,
yeah.
Ringo left for 3 weeks and Paul played drums on many of the tracks or what, you know, all yeah. the things that happened. But the White Album, when I'm going through my albums of what to put on, that's a real go-to for me. Lamb Lies yeah. Down is a total go-to for me. I love that record. And
yeah.
So it just makes me wonder, you know, because you'd think it would be born out of love and peace, but
love and peace and respect, yeah. And it's so much is turmoil and war and dissent and absence. And yet, you know, Lamb Lies Down for me. Funnily enough, I'm just reading something that was a gift from a friend, and it's Brian Eno's diary.
Oh, really?
And yeah, it's very interesting stuff. Brian Eno, very intelligent, and I worked with him when we were all very young, doing Lamb Lies Down on Broadway. And I find it very, very interesting that, in a way, working with him, and it was just for a day, so we had this grand word, inossification, on the thing. This is prior to Brian Eno becoming the producer that you know, has the success with U2.
Right, yeah.
And all.
He produced Joshua Tree, didn't he?
You know,
one of the big U2 albums. I know that. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a long association with U2 and David Bowie and all the rest.
Right.
Extraordinarily salubrious stuff. But you know, reading that and thinking, well, he's the young guy that I remember playing a club. You know, at one point in the very early days, and Genesis was not a band that everyone had heard of, and Roxy Music were our, I'm not even sure if they were the support band or we were, but Brian Eno was mixing live sound for them, and he borrowed my amp because I think you know, it's just that sort of thing.
That's great.
Early days of stuff, and then I'm reading, you know, this stuff, and he's talking about installations and all, you know, the sort of correlation between modern art and postmodernism and all the stuff. And he writes very well and couches all his arguments in, you know, great, very very eloquent and all the rest, but. You know, I just remember he came in for one day with us with Genesis, and we had most of the album recorded, etc. And he had this little sort of synth that we could put sounds through. So he did some guitar treatments and some vocal treatments.
Right.
And
so did he do was he in charge of doing that effect that it's the last great invention next to mankind thing?
Yeah, all that—that's that stuff. Yeah, all of that, and that level of technology was very similar to something I had, which was called the Synthy Hi-Fi, which was a so-called synth for guitarists. It was a guitar pedal that made guitars yodel as well as vocals yodel. So it's that kind of thing. And he had one little box where the vocals were played back through it, and everything that the singer announces came back as blah blah blah. You know, all the words went blah 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 blah. It's hugely funny. We're falling about listening to this stuff, and it was just a lot of fun because here he was coming into this tightly knit group with all its hierarchies and everything, and I thought, I wonder if he's going to survive a day working with us without being, you know, taken down a peg, torn to shreds, etc., you know, hierarchical. So, but we just had one day where nothing was hierarchical. And he just got on with doing his thing.
Yeah.
It may have been at the end of the day. But I think, you know, that's really lovely to be able to breeze in and breeze out, you know, as a sort of almost like a Japanese honored visitor, you know, mm-hmm. bestow your gifts upon us.
You're right.
In this sort of, you know, you're not going to be demoted for doing this. You just come in fresh and you're just full of ideas. And that was great, you know.
That's great.
And I think with groups, it can be very, very hard where everyone has got their allotted task and it's almost fixed. It's like the civil service, you know, or a government, you know. There's a prime minister or a president, and then there's his second in command, and blah, 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 blah. You know, you get this kind of hierarchical thing that I think people don't realize how limiting that can be. You know, in other words, somebody may have a great idea, but actually, if you're not the grand vizier, you're in no position to do that. You have to be founder member, Führer, all of these things. The groups, you know, that's why I think it's very, very interesting when someone comes in from outside, who comes in maybe just to do a solo or a vocal or to be a guest, you know, in this fixed society and stick a bob beneath it if that's what's required in order to do something entirely different that no one expected, almost as if you're quoting Monty Python and the Spanish
Inquisition. Yes.
Yeah, that's it. Nobody expects Neal Morse to come in and blow the balls up something with this vocal that he's going to do.
Yeah. Yeah, the bands. I remember Steve Morse saying to me before we made the first Flying Colors record, there was some talk about whether we should get a producer or not. And,
right.
And Steve said, well, I think we should have Peter Collins come in and produce if for no other reason we have someone else to blame besides each other when we don't like the way the record came out. Which is totally Steve. It's like that way it'll just save us from turning on each other. We can all just turn on him. We can all just blame him. Now, this is before we've recorded a note.
Right, before you've recorded a note.
Yes, he's already predicting that we're going to be very dissatisfied. It was very funny.
It's like a buffer state between, you know, the Russians and the Chinese or something.
We need someone to blame.
Everyone needs. Yes, you know, everyone needs. I shouldn't trash countries here and we're in, you know, a serious world crisis with this kind of stuff, but the buffer state that is the producer, you know, because I think that producers can come in for a lot of flack. You know, I remember talking to a very famous producer and I won't mention his name, and I said, well, what do you do when bands you know, are at each other's throat and no one could agree on anything. And he said, well, I just give them more drugs.
Well, that's one answer.
Yeah, that's one answer. Yeah, what does a producer do? Yeah, you know,
right.
He medicates sufficiently to get everyone off his back so that he can get on with the job of making the record, you know. And some producers, of course, you can do everything. I remember being interviewed on British TV when it was the death of the late great George Martin, and they were asking me on the 6 o'clock news, what does the producer do? And I said, well, a producer can do everything or nothing.
Right.
And what I should have said was that in George Martin's case, was he Beatle number five? And I would counter with, yes, I think he was Beatle number five and six. You know, that it's so important that the producer's role, if somebody like that is coming up with orchestrations.
Yeah, horn arrangements and all that, yeah.
Arrangements and taking songs in their fledgling form and suggesting that perhaps we should start with the chorus, etc.
I mean, right, yeah. I wanted to talk about the day that we did High Voltage together.
Yes, that's right.
Didn't they tell everybody to be there at like some ungodly hour, like 7:15 a.m.?
Oh, that's right. Yes, yes. You've got a good memory there. Yeah, of course. And I was just coming on for the encore of the encore or whatever it was with you guys.
Yeah.
Transatlantic. And It was, I hadn't played that song since about 1972, I think. And, Hogweed, as you described it as the old war horse, and you're quite right, you know. And, but, you know, it felt great. I seem to remember that you guys took the pace a little faster than the original on the record.
I'm sure we did.
Gains, you know what? It only gains from being slightly faster. So when I re-recorded it again with you very kindly on vocal, we took your pace, really, at that, you know, so it was snappier and it had a sort of almost a kind of punky pace to it, you know, and I enjoyed it for that extra energy. And I thought you did a great job on the vocals.
Oh, thank you. Thanks a lot, man.
Yeah.
Well, I thought you did a great job at that gig. But I just thought it was so funny. Over those 2 days, you and I wound up spending a bunch of time together. Do you remember that? I think it was the day before that we were supposed to rehearse, but you and I were the only ones that made it. You and I were the only ones that showed up. Do you remember that?
Probably. Yes, yes, I do. And that was in a house.
Yes, at a friend of mine's house, yeah.
In the annals of memory, that's where I remember showing up, and Pete was on bass, and he showed up, I'm sure.
I don't think he did. I think that there was some horrible accident, and like that neither one of them could get there or something. So I just had lunch in that little backyard area, and then
What's strange is that I'm sure that some of the band were literally turning up on the day of the gig, you know, overnight flights and very little sleep and what have you. And so
and then on that morning, it was just me, you, and Joe. We were the only ones that showed up on time. Do you remember that? Well, everybody else showed up at like 9 o'clock, and we were just there having coffee for a while before anything happened. That's what I remember anyway.
Well, that's right. You know, one tries to be professional about these things. It's not rock and roll. Don't get any votes for that. You know,
I appreciate that.
Is what everyone is. Rock and roll, yeah. It's like, you know, and he was shooting up. And it was... the truth is that God, I've had that. I remember playing with Evelyn Glennie on the London stage, where she's doing percussion. She's got this OBE from the Queen and everything, and Scottish percussionist, girl percussionist.
Uh-huh.
And, she gets there at every gig at 6 a.m, starts unloading this Pantechnicon.
Wow.
And we're doing an interview on stage before the gig, and she starts berating me because I didn't show up, or my equipment didn't show up until 10 a.m. And I said, well, actually, my crew had to come in from, you know, 2 hours away. And you know, why was it that your equipment was late and all this sort of stuff? And I was like, oh, I see.
Wow.
I can only account for myself. Others, you know, there's human need or there's this thing called geography, you know.
Right.
But there.
I thought it was great that you were so diligent about it. I mean, you were just doing the spot at the end, but that was all part of it coming off so well. And, and what a great time that was.
Yeah.
And I was so glad I didn't make a scene, because for the whole first 20 minutes of that set, as I recall, I had feedback coming through my monitor that was like a foghorn.
Do you know the
like continuous.
But that is what happens at festivals, isn't it? That's the beauty of festivals. Or rather, the beauty and the beast of festivals is something goes wrong and you don't have time to fix it because a band is on, then the next contestant who wants to play.
And so but I made a conscious decision, because it can be very distracting for the audience, you know, if you get up there and especially like the first thing you do is like, hey, I need my, you know, because I've seen people do that. I saw Greg Lake do that at High Voltage with the at the ELP reunion thing. And it just kind of makes a weird vibe for the audience, like, oh, he's upset, and you know. So I just decided I was just going to ignore it. I mean, and it was like the first 20 minutes of the thing. It was pretty hard to ignore. But I was really glad I did, yes, because it turns, I asked Rich Mauser, the front of house guy, afterwards, like, what about that feedback? In fact, Mike says it. I think if you watch the YouTube or whatever of our performance, I think he says, here's the four guys and the fifth member of the band, the feedback. It's because we had all this feedback in our monitors the whole time, but Rich did not have it. And when I watched it on TV, I was like, oh, it's fine. So
I seem to recall that we were playing away on stage, my band, the following day, and one side of the PA went out for a substantial part of one of the numbers. And on stage, we were unaware of that because that is facing the audience. But, right, you know, that could be any one of the audience walking past somebody's dog kicking out a plug somewhere. But that's the live experience, isn't it? You know,
it is. Have you ever been playing at the pool stage on the cruise, and then they have their announcements like, it'll have to be a trivia. We'll have trivia on the third deck, and don't forget the sculptures, the ice sculptures. They have all these announcements. Well, on the pool deck, the last year or so, they said because of safety regulations, they have to cut the PA and have that stuff go through the PA during your gig.
Oh my God!
Yeah.
Oh dear. Well,
I was so glad Mike didn't have it in his ears, or he would have. Yeah. I don't think he would have been very happy about that.
No, there is that. Yes, I mean, there will be times in the course of a lifetime when you'll be. What is it? This comes down to Spinal Tap. You know, the puppet show must go on, or whatever it is. There's something going on. I mean, I've done some stuff, some French Canadian stuff where we're playing away and there's another band have either started up or we're playing over the top of them, and you go, well, hey, I can't do anything about that. I'm booked to play now. That's me. This is my slot. So, we all want the Immaculate Conception, and we settle for rock and roll at the end of the day. So.
At the end of the day. That is right, sir. Yeah.
So,
well, I'm such a big fan, Steve.
Thank you. And me too. And it's been great talking. And I have to love you and leave you at this point.
That's all right, man. Thank you for playing the solo that you played on my album, the Question Mark album.
Pleasure.
It's a beautiful, beautiful solo.
And thank you.
Love it.
Thank you for what you've done for me as well. So hopefully we'll do stuff in the future. And
love that.
So all those fans out there who've been listening to us wittering on about our our glories and our defeats, it's just great to share it all, really.
Yeah. Ultimately, if it really is all about, all the result of the music,
that's it.
Then we are very blessed indeed.
Yeah, indeed. Indeed. So all the best to you.
All the best to you. All the best to Joe. And
thank you.
Look forward to seeing you whenever time permits. Yeah.
Indeed.
Always good to be with you, Steve. Thank you for doing this.
All the best.
All right, man.
Okay. All the best.